looming straight up and over us, like a solid iron figurehead suddenly thrust into our vision, stood Captain Ahab. His whole high, broad form weighed down upon a barbaric white leg carved from the jawbone of a whale. He did not feel the wind or smell the salt air. He only stood staring at the horizon with the marks of some inner crucifixion and woe deep in his face.
Mr. Starburn.
Sir?
Call everybody here.
This is the artwork associated with the Ahab Pen. The filler reminds me most of the old 19th century baling mechanisms. They used to have them on a seesaw, and there would be, on some models, a pump on each side with leather bushings, sometimes vegetable oil or whale oil or just plain lard as the seal, long before they had silicone. And it would act to keep the ship's hold as dry as possible. As most people know, Ahab had a leg issue. And in the artwork, this bailing mechanism, inspired by a combination of vintage mechanisms, early 1920s and World War II. In World War II, there was rationing of rubber, and this mechanism is similar to those that were very common during the war years that limited the amount of rubber to a single washer. This one uses a modern O-ring. It's a much more reliable seal, longer-lasting seal, than what was used then. But it's similar in design, with the exception that, like the 19th century baler, there's an exchange of air, and in essence it winds up being a valve based on physics. There's a breather tube that goes into the hollow pump tube, and as you push it down, it's going to push air out. As you draw it up, it draws ink in. And the second time you push it down, the air is driven out right to the very end of the filler up here. And the pen is then full. Now, I'll demonstrate that. But before I do so, I'd like to point out that unlike the World War II versions that had a solid rod that didn't fill, and that were somewhat inefficient in terms of their barrel space utilization, this takes advantage of the World War II design, which was very useful in terms of the Morrison Patriot comes to mind. An insulated layer of air between the ink chamber and the barrel. This is very important because it protects the air that's in the chamber as the ink is used up from the heat of your hand. And it greatly hinders the ability of the air to expand in response to that higher temperature and cause drooling. If any drooling is caused, unlike with an eyedropper, where if you can fill this pen as an eyedropper, but if you were to do that, and it's eyedropper filling, when the air level gets this big, the likelihood of the heat of your hand expanding that air and pushing it out the nib is much higher than with the self-filling version installed, where the heat hits this insulative air barrier and prevents that temperature reaction from taking place. as well as the fact that the breather tube, as with in Parker 51s and certain pens with breather tubes, enables the air to expand more easily through the breather tube and out. But unlike the original Dunn and bulb fillers and all the other pens that had breather tubes, it's got an insulated barrel. If you want the capacity of a 1920 Dunn, for instance, would fill right up to the end of the barrel and into the blind cap. Well, this can just be filled as an eyedropper, and you've got every bit of barrel space utilized. So either way, if you don't care about insulation and you're going to do a huge amount of drawing or writing in one setting, that might be the way to go. If you're not going to do a huge amount of writing in one setting, I'd recommend using the self-filling mechanism to take advantage of that additional insulation and control that this pen enables. Now, the artwork shows Ahab in a stove boat with the catfish and the sperm whale destroying the Pequod. This is a huge balancing act in terms of cost management versus what you could get for the equivalent pen in terms of total costs elsewhere. Even in the United States, if this were entirely made in the United States, this would be a very expensive pen, probably in the $200 range. If it were made in Europe, the quotes I've gotten in the past on nibs, on ebonite, on just the parts that go into making this pen, the pen could be in the $350, $400 range. So to get this down to $20 retail with this size and its ability to be restored and repaired with relative ease, as I intend to show you, this was threading a camel through the eye of the needle, I can assure you. And I hope it's recognized that it is possible to get a fountain pen competitive with anything on the shelf in one of the major stores. A reusable fountain pen. Nothing about this pen is disposable. And to me, that's a mammoth advantage over the rollerballs and the other writing instruments that are part of a disposable culture that, if you only do the math, it's stunningly wasteful. Cartridge pens, Noodlers won't issue a cartridge. We developed a cartridge that could fit every single known manufacturer's pen. And when the manufacturers of the plastics that go into cartridges gave us the final quotes, it was so stunningly expensive that it was determined that each cartridge, in terms of volume of ink, would cost the consumer the equivalent of $107 per the equivalent of a 3-ounce Noodlers bottle. And that's one of the huge reasons Noodlers will never issue cartridges, and any pen you see introduced here by me is not going to be a cartridge pen. It's going to be a self-filler, and I'm going to try my best to make sure that it can be serviced and maintained well after I'm dead by you, nobody else. That's who you will have to rely on at a certain point. And I'm going to try to design them so that by going to the local hardware store with a dollar in your pocket, you'll be able to maintain parts that wear out. And seals, no matter how well they are manufactured, seals move, they're subject to wear, and eventually they will wear out. And it's part of the design that enables the user to have a more efficient and more productive experience with it than Adding complexity for complexity's sake does not add to living standards. If you get an expensive watch and it's impossible to fix, and it's dead after you spent $5,000 on it, what good did it do you? It just robbed you of the $5,000. And it's my hope that even if one encounters problems with a seal later on, that the design, the robustness of the design will assist you in being able to fix any contingency that happens in the future that's completely unseen at the current time, and that the ease of disassembly and the ease of replacing seals will be of great assistance. And if I'm crazy as Ahab for trying to do that and maintain prices that are within the realm of the cost of a bottle of ink for a fountain pen like this, well, then go ahead and call me crazy. I obviously long ago no longer cared. Some of the stuff said online could fill a book. Now, about the pen, this is a picture of a right whale, a bowhead whale. And this is a picture of a sperm whale. And here is the clip of this Ahab pen. It says Noodler's Ink on it. There's a widening out that's very similar to the tail of both species. Doesn't quite widen out here unless you count the ring of the clip. And then the streamlined curve as it teardrops down from above. Now, if any of you know what a right whale or a bowhead whale looks like from the side, it's quite thick, as is the sperm whale. But from above, it appears to taper to a point. And the design of the clip follows that pattern. Just like the whale and the tail. The band is heavy and sturdy and is part of the injection molding process. And you can post it pretty hard. Nothing happens. It's meant to prevent long-term stress on this particular point. I've always liked the models from the 30s and 40s that had rim bands. After 40 to 50 years of use, they were the ones that experienced by far virtually no cracks in many models. When you get the pen, the instruction sheet has the artwork here, called the Ahab Pen and Noodler's Ink in the Waves. This artwork, of course, done with Noodler's Ink. And on the other side, it describes the two types of filling. The first, self-filling. There is an O-ring seal here, and that keeps this ink tight, watertight. And then an O-ring seal in the main chamber, and this is your filler O-ring. When you get the pen, when this O-ring is new and fresh, it's going to be a little bit tight. So you might have to push with some strength to get it to move. That initial movement, you can try to twist and push or hold it firmly with these fingers like this and push down with your thumb, straight down. Do not push to the sides and stress the filler, but push straight down. But once it moves even a millimeter, even if the freshest of O-rings will slide just like this, pinky finger. Just like that. Now, no adhesive there, it disassembles. And this is all in your instructions. It'll tell you how to do this. Your filler rod end piece is threaded. It unscrews just like that. Very easy. Push this out, it pops out into your hand, and you can then replace this with a faucet O-ring of like size at Home Depot or Lowe's or your local hardware store. It literally fits in the groove there. I'm using a rounded point tool, but you can do this with a toothpick. You just go in, under, and up. There's your O-ring. You don't even need that tool anymore for installation. A little bit of lubrication. This is by design. Press it over with your fingers until it gets over the groove and it pops in place. You'll note this little O-ring here. That O-ring can also be moved, and this is also in your instructions, with a toothpick. You can take this O-ring and move it forward. And leaving the breather tube there, your pen is now an eyedropper. And you can fill this entire barrel of ink with ink, if that's your preference. In the instructions, it shows you, here is your self-filler, filled right to the end, and here is your barrel, filled right to the end. Different capacity of ink, but just be aware that this is non-insulated and this is insulated. And that can make a difference. Also in your instructions, there is a groove here in the section that matches this nib. So when you're reassembling this, be aware that this nib must match that groove when you put it back together again. It's an handmade ebonite feed with numerous finning, usually about 17 fins each side. And if you get a quote for a feed like this, wholesale in Europe, some of the quotes were actually higher than the retail price of this pen here in the United States. Just for your information. In the instructions, it shows how with the use of a packing knife or a razor blade, you can open additional air vents to increase the flow of your feed. Now, for most writing, the existing open air vent is the first air vent here, and that's all you need. If you flex a lot, and you need the pen to be a gusher, you can go back 3, 4, and 5. But eventually you might get to the point where for regular writing, it starts to be too wet. Now if you overshoot the mark, and your particular ink combination with this feed and pen starts to get so wet that you want it to go back the other way, you can always take a tiny, tiny amount of either paraffin or slightly tacky rolled rubber cement, and you simply put it in some of the fins on the side, nowhere near the main channel, but on the side to prevent air from getting into the channel, and basically restore it to the same restriction that it was earlier, before the adjustment. To my knowledge, none of the vintage pens enabled anybody to adjust flow in this way on a handmade ebonite feed. And this is the first of its kind in that regard. Throughout my life, I have always had to adjust flow based on the depth of cut and the depth of the air channel. The deeper the air channel and the deeper the main channel, the more the flow would be. This, to an extent, helps increase the airflow and increase the flow down. Some of you, if you're really flexing like crazy and you need the ink to flow to such a degree that it has to drool it out onto the page because you're always full flexing, well, you might actually have to deepen the channel a bit. I'm hoping that the adjustment for airflow is sufficient to cover most artist uses. The pen is already pretty much okay for writing purposes, but I'd like it to be to have the utility for the artist as well. Now, to reassemble, you just align the channel under the nib slit up to about there. You find the inset groove in the section, and it's right here. Don't know if the camera can pick that up, but it's right there. And the nib goes into that groove. Now, the feed has to be aligned with the slit. Has to be fairly perfect that way. And if looking through it, you can see the groove matching the slit of the nib. And you push the nib all the way down, and the end of the slit will meet the section edge. For reassemble of the filler unit, the reassembly, slide it so that it's back there, push it with your finger, screw on the end, pull it back down, and push it down about here, and carefully aim the breather tube into the center. Do not put it on the side, but aim it through the center, otherwise it's not going to function. And also, if you've been using it as an eyedropper and want to return it to self-filler status, remember, you got to bring that O-ring back down between the filler unit and the section. Now, the breather tube should end around here. If it's down here somewhere, it's going to miss the entrance to the filler. And it's an easy fix. You simply pull the breather tube out from the ebonite feed slightly until you get it so that when it's set, it approximates this level into the filler. That way there, every time it moves, the breather tube is always in the center of the hollow filler. Now to demonstrate how it works.
Look here. Logbooks from the time New Bedford men first went a whaling helped me draw this chart. It divides the oceans into areas of 5 degrees of latitude by 5 of longitude. Here are the months of the years, the ships that passed, how long they lingered, the whales. whales they saw. What size, what color, how many, where heading.
This is a recent ink that might be familiar to you, called the Blue Nose Bear. I was going to demonstrate Bernanke Blue again, but I think that fella has enough problems. Cover the ink up to the section level, like so. See the slight amount of air bubbles. Draw up. Full. Two strokes. And that's it. And then wipe the excess off. You can do three strokes to get out every single little tiny bubble. There's a tiny bubble in the filler that could have been expelled. But two strokes is enough to fill it well. When you run out of ink, due to capillary action, the end of the filler will sometimes keep ink in it, in this hollow filler tube. And if you find yourself completely out of ink and you need to get that last sentence done, this filler tube will sometimes act as an ink reserve. You push it forward, and then the breather tube enables greater capillary action in this rear filler tube, and the ink has access then, through that capillary action, to the feed. And you get an extra paragraph, two paragraphs, sometimes a page, depending upon whether you're flexing or not, out of your pen. Just before you need to refill it. It gives you an extra cushion of safety, and it also is letting you know that it needs to be refilled. This pen has never been used before. After the ink is set in the feed overnight, you might notice that it begins to improve its flow characteristics. If you want to speed up that process and get it to flow with greater vim and vigor at an earlier moment, these handmade feeds use cutting oils to make these fins. And despite the best efforts, some cutting oils might occasionally still be in the ebonite. And if the nib and feed are removed and you scrub it, an old toothbrush would be fine, with a mixture of ammonia, dish soap, the liquid dish soap that breaks up oils and greases like Ajax, liquid Dawn, palm olive, some of the liquid dish soaps that are like that, pretty much anything that cuts grease off of a pan will do the same with any cutting oil that a new pen might encounter. And that will assist flow. But over time, the flow is going to improve anyway. But for the artist who wants to get that extra wet line, and you want to see it immediately, you might want to run a rinse through this, just in case. This one isn't that bad. I did encounter one that had a little bit more in terms of cutting oils that remained in the feed and needed to be cleaned out with some ammonia and soapy water. But you see, it's the flex action of this larger pen is quite nice. This isn't much pressure. Now, one can measure the pressure of the wet noodle, and you can look at the side and the amount of flex provided by the so-called vintage 100-year-old wet noodles. A lot of that feel on the page is because of bending like this, and it's not necessarily just flexing out, it's also a lot of bending like a saw blade. This one's like a more Maniflex nib from the 30s. That's pretty much what it's been aimed at. And that one doesn't have as much of the saw blade when it was flexible back then. Flex responded more directly to the opening. And as a result, you wind up with that immediate widening. Always wind up messing up these pieces of paper because it's fun. I don't know why. It's just making doodles across a page, flexing a nib, but it's fun. It's always been fun. It's completely incoherent doodling, but even this, to me, and to some people out there who know what I'm talking about, for some crazy reason, even this is beautiful. To empty the pen, the only thing left is the reserve up here, which, if the pen were empty, you'd use. But you can empty the reserve with a second plunge. And you've evacuated the entire chamber, and then you can rinse this out with water. I'm not going to do that, because I want to show how it fills as an eyedropper. Go diagonal with the toothpick, or this is very smooth. There's no cutting edge on it. You do not want to have an aberration cut your O-ring at all. You want the O-ring sides to only touch things that are smooth. Plastic toothpicks, if you can get them, they're perfect. Your empty barrel. As you can see, it holds a lot of ink this way. Right up, a little into the threads. You could probably see in the video went from about here to down here. Now that's one pen filling out of a 3-ounce bottle. It's a good quantity. It's right next to the end of the threads, the beginning of the smooth part of the section. That way there it won't get caught in the threads when you turn it into an eyedropper. Till it exhibits flattened sides. You just tighten it until it exhibits flattened sides here. Some of you have Heart of Darkness and you have that pen, know exactly what I'm talking about. And then you write with it as an eyedropper. Still has some Now this feed has not been opened at all, but just to demonstrate, how wide this nib can get, can go all the way to here, but to get out to this width, you need to open up the feed a bit. This is normal writing with normal flex, which does just fine with this opening. But the moment you get out to these artistic widths, it's going to need a lot more ink, and it will definitely once you get out to the absolute maximum, it'll definitely need some type of feed tinkering. But it pumps a nice line. Especially slow and steady. That little capillary link between the two tines that the film of ink creates when you're flexing, at a certain point, it can break, like right up here, getting that far out. That is, that's approximately 2.5 millimeters. This, on the other hand, with the existing setting, that's about upwards of a millimeter and a half. And then the moment you get out to 2.5, you need more ink. Now you can cheat, and instead of adjusting the feed, you simply unscrew it and screw it back as an eyedropper, or move the filler a little bit and fill all the fins of the feed if you're going to do a flourish that requires that extra wide nib flexing. Those aren't full width that it's capable of with adjustment. This is only what it's naturally capable of without adjustment. But I figure most users probably aren't going to fiddle with the ebonite. Because if you fiddle too far with the ebonite, some of it's irreversible and then you have to block some of the air channels. And my apologies in advance on the supply of these pens. We keep missing how many people actually want these, and the estimates of demand have been off. That has to do with the price, and I know a lot of dealers have basically said, well, raise the price, and you'll put demand in equilibrium with your supply. The price isn't going to be raised, and there's a reason for that. My goal here isn't to become some sort of millionaire or something. My goal here is to make this instrument more competitive with the rollerball that you find at Walmart. I want the fountain pen to be more competitive in every measure, including economic. And to raise the price because of a short-term shortage that I still believe can be solved over a longer period, and maintain quality and gradually improve quality and design as time goes on without raising the price, I think is a far more honorable goal, and will provide greater satisfaction both to Noodler's customers and to yours truly. The option for an artist or somebody who's going to do a lot of calligraphy is, of course, to remove this. This particular instance, the pen is filled with Noodler's Black. Its archival quality and durability being why it's being demonstrated. Now, for the artist, if you keep using this and the air bubble gets bigger and bigger and bigger, you won't have to refill it. But if you like using it as an eyedropper and you use it daily, try to keep the air bubble rather small. Fairly fine line with a very, very light touch. A very fine line, but still dark. Back to a fine again. Very little pressure. And then back out. Well, anyway, it's a bigger nib. It's pretty capable as an eyedropper. I wanted you to see it using black because the contrast of black on white paper is pretty good. If you're experiencing a high humid environment, black tends to resist the urge to feathering. In fact, that's why Noodlers offers anti-feather black, to resist that. The higher the humidity, the more feathering you're going to get from some of the more conventional inks. With moderate pressure, you get more or less a medium. With the ventless nib, and because this is a streamlined section for the comfort of the grip, you might find yourself occasionally shifting to the side. If you shift to the side enough, of course, the pen ceases to write. You have to be aware of keeping the nib towards the ceiling. A brief note on one other reason why Noodlers Inc. will not be issuing any cartridges. Somebody used one of these down in the Caribbean. Perhaps they were writing on a beach during some vacation on Barbados or in the Bahamas. And they have a narrow entrance here. And if there's even the slightest bubble here, they float. In certain circumstances, in some types of water, they float even if there isn't a bubble. And as they soak up the water, this particular plastic gets softer and softer. Some of you may have noticed that you feel as if you've been cheated when you get a cartridge because it's half full. This stuff evaporates right out of the wall. A glass bottle, it can't do that. It's yet another reason Noodlers will never make these suckers. They float around, look like a jellyfish, and these very large sea turtles. If you've ever experienced a sea turtle, if you've been canoeing, kayaking, you're on a boat, or you're near a dock, and one comes to the surface and exhales, it can scare you. They're very large, and they can surprise you, and they're quite majestic. And it takes a long time for them to grow. One of them ingested one of these cartridges, and its digestive tract became fouled, infected, and it wound up weakening and got caught up in the Gulf Stream and wound up here in Massachusetts and died on a beach. This happened a while ago, but the biologist who performed the autopsy on it found one of these. Now, the math indicates this is a pure rip-off product. Bottled ink beats it regardless of manufacturer. So there's no real reason except this disposable consumer culture of just wasting resources without doing the math. I can assure you that during the Depression and during World War II, when they tried to come out with cartridges, they didn't take off. And they didn't take off in the 1890s. They never competed with the eyedropper or the self-filler. And then magically, at a certain moment in the post-war history, disposable units took off. But now the math is so compelling because the price of disposables has gone up relative to self-fillers and the like. They never were cheaper. They've always cost more, but now they cost a lot more in relative terms if you do the math. And given that it'll take energy to recycle it, more so than if you used a self-filling pen. If you dispose of it, it'll take forever for it to rot. And if it's improperly disposed of, you can kill a sea turtle. Noodlers doesn't issue them. That's because of my stubbornness and because of how I view these things. It's the only ink company in the world that does not issue cartridges. It's of equivalent size and larger. Nobody else refuses absolutely to ever issue cartridges. And Noodlers does refuse to ever issue one of these unconscionable little things. I wanted to tell you why, and my full view of it. It is not purely because of environmentalism. It's mostly because of the math, because I believe I should offer products that I can, in my own conscience, know they are a good deal for the consumer, as good a deal as I can manage. And these, they're very profitable. They're extraordinarily profitable. The markups are huge, and the costs are higher at every step of the way. If it were purely economics is tricky that way. Longer term, it makes more sense to avoid these things. Short term, a company can drink the Kool-Aid. But longer term, I'm convinced everyone will see the math for what it is, and they will find out those who promoted them and those who didn't. And long term, the economic consequences of that are not as pleasant for those who promoted them. That is my view of it. And you won't ever see those from Noodlers.